this like going up on YouTube so people can actually like see it later.
Yes, that is nice.
But please tell me you got week one read.
I did get it read, yes. I got my pages done.
Sweet, you are like a star pupil right now in my eyes.
But some of the exercises for week one I was having problems with.
Well, let's talk about that. What's up? What have you been struggling with?
Well, my biggest problem is that I don't have very many memories of, I guess, my childhood.
Okay.
Like, a lot of it is pretty much blank.
It's like we went live.
I'm sorry.
We are live.
Okay.
Record.
Awesome.
Can you see?
Yes.
Check
thank you.
Chat. Check. Check. Google Hangout chat.
You will thank you.
There. Yeah, Google Hangout chat.
Yes. Thank you, Dave. Brenda, go ahead.
So, my yeah, what's that? Just, what's that?
I said my techie is just working on things for me, so. Anyways, you were saying childhood.
Yeah, so, like, all these questions here about, like, time travel. Like, mm-hmm. like I said, I don't have any memories of anything of really back in my childhood that I can relate with any of these, right?
Mm-hmm.
Most of it's pretty much a blank. So I've had this book for a while, actually, and I struggled with those areas because I don't know mm-hmm. what I don't know what to put, right?
Yeah.
So
that makes sense. For me, like what I would say would be to potentially like imagine into that. I mean, really actually engage your imagination into what, you know, maybe like not even a literal childhood, but maybe like a metaphorical childhood of like you in a previous state, like maybe in a teenage year or something like that. Because,
mm-hmm.
I mean, for me personally, I don't really have much like solid recollection of my younger childhood years either.
But, oh, okay.
But, you know, fifth grade on, I remember that, you know?
Okay.
So, I mean, you can, the definition of childhood can vary.
Right.
So, with that awareness, like, what would you do differently?
Well, then, that's like you said, you know, you probably use the imagination and try and go in through things that way, right?
Yeah.
And after, like, a certain time in my life, like, after age of 12, there really wasn't a whole lot of, there wasn't really a whole lot of childhood for me, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so there was not a lot of time available to me for any creative pursuits back then anyway. So,
yeah.
You know, I was too busy being surrogate mother. So.
You're one of those girls. Ah, I
yeah.
get you. I get you. Oh. Well, this process is really about, like, reclaiming that childhood and being able to have that childhood you never really had and being able to put it on paper, you know? So that would be an interesting task for you. I'm happy that you actually went through and did some of the tasks, or at least attempted to, because I actually didn't even assign that yet. I was just having people do the reading first, so you're like ahead of the game.
Brown noser!
Brown noser. I love it. That's good, though. It's good. So, you said you've been through this book before a little bit. Like, what did you get from reading it this time that, like, in the actual reading bits that you didn't get before?
Well, I guess, see, I've been that way with books before. I'll pick it up. I'm like, oh, this is really cool. But if I'm not in the right spot, I guess, you know, I can read through a book and I not really get anything from it. But this time around, it actually, a lot of it really made sense to me, right? Now that I actually, I think I'm in the right spot in my life for this mm-hmm. and just the right time. So, how do I put that? What are my right words? I guess it makes me, or I can see now how everything becomes a creative process in your life in general, right? Like everything you do basically is a state of creation, right? Mm-hmm. And so after reading this, I was able to look back on other areas of my life and say, okay, well, yeah, I can apply this to that scenario, right? And see how it's starting to work and make sense to me. So that was good.
Sweet.
Yeah.
How did you relate to, I'm just going to throw out like a concept, like the idea of like protecting that little artist within you that for me, when I read through this chapter this time, like what really stood out for me was that the idea of really having that safety, that protection of being able to not expose your little budding artistic self to too mm-hmm. much criticism and negativity and not really putting yourself around people or environments that are going to tear you down, because that's something that some of us have a tendency to do, and then it just completely shit like all of our hopes and dreams and aspirations of getting anywhere with our artwork are shot to hell, you know?
Right, and I can actually relate to that completely, because I think for me as growing up, like I was the youngest of 8 kids in my family, and my mom and dad ended up getting 7 foster children. So when the foster kids came along, I was kind of the middle child all of a sudden, right? And so with my older family, there was a lot of issues with my brothers and sisters, and then with the foster kids, being how like they had come from native reserves and stuff, there was a lot of issues there. So mm-hmm. I kind of fell in the cracks, right? And so I think for a lot of my life, I was always trying to find validation, I think, in some areas. And then this, you know, now I've learned that I don't need somebody else's approval or validation, I needed to find it within myself, right? And so this has been a process for me, and I've part of, I took an online painting course, and part of it was like a Facebook group, and everybody's, you know, they're posting their pictures and everything, and they're looking for, like you said, validation of that. And, you know, a couple times I was tempted to, and then I just kind of pulled back, and it's like, no, you know, I don't want that or need that yet, right?
Yeah.
And so I've just kind of been working through things on my own, so to speak.
Yeah. Okay. Well, how did you feel when you were doing some of the affirmations?
They are getting easier, right? Initially, when I started them, it feels kind of, I don't know, weird and quirky, right? You know? It's like,
yeah.
It's completely, completely foreign to me, right? So it was one of those things where when I was growing up, you always put yourself last type thing, right? And so saying some of these affirmations to make yourself, you know, put yourself in the forefront was like completely, you know, completely odd, I guess. So, but the more you do it, the better and easier it becomes, right?
Correct.
So I'm liking that now. It's getting easier.
Do they feel more impactful and powerful to you? Like when you're speaking them, does it feel like more embodied?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, you know, get to the point where you really start believing and saying that, yeah, that really is, that's great, and that's where I am, and that's who I am. And so, yeah, it's been great.
One of the things that I really like about them is just the fact that, like, they resonate on that level of the deepest self. You know, maybe
yes.
our conscious mind doesn't necessarily believe it fully and wholly right now, but there's part of us that, the biggest part of us, you know, that really, really does believe it, because we understand that our gifts are from God, or source, or whatever the hell you want to call it, you know?
Right.
And that it isn't really a bad thing to be making art, or to be doing your art, or to be engaging your creativity.
Yeah.
Looks like you're getting a bit of an interruption for a minute, but hello. I actually have a message that's popping up on my screen. Somebody's trying to get into the call, and they need some help for a second.
Okay,
so
no problem.
My screen's going to pause for a second.
Okay, sure.
All right. Just a moment.
Okay. No, why did I do that?
All right.
Pause.
Okay. Seems like a lot of people are having problems getting on the call tonight.
Pause.
I don't know why, but everything's all, like, technically challenged today. Dave's computer right now is acting up, and that's why he's not talking, is because his microphone's crackling too much, and...
Oh, okay.
All this, like, technical stuff is just like, wah! Oh, there's Krista. Krista got on the call. Hello?
Is your madre on? I would go to your house, but I have people here in my house. I almost didn't get on.
Call her, if you could call her on her cell phone, I think she's not understanding how you do it. I told her she just goes to that Facebook group, clicks the link, and it'll take her to it. She's thinking she needs to sign into Google Plus and all this kind of stuff. Like she is kind of technically challenged sometimes. Okay, thank you.
Look at these ladies. Hang on, check this out, Katerina. Hey, can you get on? Okay, so log into your Facebook.
Okay.
Yes. No, log into your Facebook.
Honey. What?
So many smiling faces.
Better. Can you hear me?
Your Facebook information.
Your Facebook.
Katerina, next chat.
Yes, Dave.
I'll see if I'm even coming through at all.
That's very, very minimal.
I text Katerina.
You're very quiet. It's very hard to hear you. Krista?
Yeah, I'm here.
Could you mute your mic?
Okay, so go to your messages. Yes. No, your inbox. Yes. The one that Katerina. Yes. Yes, Katerina.
Could you mute your mic while you're talking to her? I'm trying to talk to Dave really quick.
Yep. Hang on just a second.
Oh. Okay. Yes, Dave?
Can you hear?
Yeah, kind of. I'm saying it's very faint.
Text chat. Google Hangouts chat. Google text chat. Can you hear me now? Coming through. Google Hangout text chat. Can you hear? Am I coming through? Google Hangout text chat.
Shh. Okay. Your voice is very garbly. Okay. Oh, this is quite an ordeal.
Can you hear me?
Dave, I'm telling you, no, it's very, very...
I'm on.
Hello. You're on. Hello.
Okay. Okay, got it.
Brenda, I appreciate your patience right now. I really do.
No worries.
I really do. We'll get this figured out eventually, and it'll be like, you know, easy, and everything will be like smooth sailing. Is everybody good? Hello, everybody. Can we start now?
Can anybody hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
I can't hear anybody.
I can hear you.
I can hear you too.
My volume's on.
It's like text chat.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Krista, do you think her...
Katerina, my video. Get my video, Katerina. Come on, you can do it. Look at
Dave,
my
video. Dave, I'm telling you, I see it. Dave, what do you need in the text chat?
I'm gonna make up right now.
What needs to happen now in the text chat?
Bring me all the makeup, and then you guys go play in the bedrooms.
We're in trouble!
If you guys want to play with the gingerbread houses, go to the room. If you guys...
I would really like to get started, so if anybody who is distracted right now, like Dave, I need you to tell me what you need right now so we can get started. Because it's been about half an hour since I wanted to start, and everybody's now kind of rolling in. And I need you to tell me, Dave, what it is that you're asking for, so I can deal with that, and then we can get started, okay? All right. Just a moment, everyone. Ian's having a hang up. Hang on just a second. All right. She just needs her volume situation resolved because we all can hear her, right, Brenda? You can hear her.
Yes.
Yeah, but she can't hear any of us.
Katerina, can you read what Dave wrote?
Yep. For my cell phone, I've used them on this before.
Let me
yeah,
see
that's for hearing. But
Katerina.
Hear you. That's not.
Yeah,
I can't hear anything.
Stop.
I don't see what Dave wrote.
Headphone.
It says it's gone. Right here.
Everybody else can hear everybody else. Thank you for taking a moment to help me.
Should be working at all.
I don't hear anyone.
It says it's working right now, so
you just gotta be louder.
Maybe your earphones are broken. We all hear just fine, and your beeping of your phone.
Katerina?
Don't know why.
Yes, Krista.
Okay. Leanne, mm-hmm. Can you mute your microphone for a minute, sweetheart, please? Katerina, to the right-hand side of your screen, or the left-hand side, I'm sorry, at the very top, it'll say chat.
Mm-hmm.
Can you open that? Can you double-click on that? And then what will happen is on the right-hand side of your screen, it will pop up a group chat, and Dave has been trying to tell you what's going on. What happened is his main computer shut down completely.
Uh-huh.
So he said that if you were actually looking at the chat, he could participate. But that's not happening because you can't see it, because you're probably looking at it like in your Gmail. but you actually have to go and hover over the left-hand side of your screen and where it says chat, and then it says screen share, Q&A, capture.
I'm on something completely different.
I can hear you guys. It's very choppy, though.
Can you mute yours really quickly, Leanne, for me, sweetie?
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, sorry. What'd you say, honey?
I was saying that I can still hear feedback. I don't know where from. Anyway, I'm saying that I'm on Google Hangouts on my phone, on my iPhone. So
that's why you can't read it. Okay, that's okay. Okay.
So my apologies.
No. Okay, so basically, the only way that he can participate is text. So if you want, I don't know how to do it from an iPhone. I honestly have no idea. He tried writing it on paper and putting it into the video window, but he still didn't think you understood.
I didn't. It just looked like he was freaking out.
He laughed.
Okay.
So he apologizes. What I'll do is I'll read what he's saying. He says, if anyone could read this and verbalize it, that will work. And okay, cool. I'll tell him, I got you, Dave.
Awesome. I mean, his role in all of this is pretty much to be my techie and to kind of be making sure everything's functioning all right with my Costa Rican internet over here. So, okay.
Well, I got him.
Okay, cool.
I'll be his interpreter, right. And I'll send him a bill later.
Okay. Are we all ready to get started? Leanne, are you ready?
She's on mute.
I really am not able to be hearing clearly. Everything is very, very choppy. I'm getting like one out of every three or four words.
Earphones.
Earphones.
I don't have earphones here, so I'm screwed. Oh, yeah, I do. Hang on, big ones. I got big ones. Woo-hoo.
We'll get this all down, folks. We'll get this all down, and it'll be a lot easier. Okay, are we ready to start now?
I think I can hear you guys. Can you hear me?
I can hear you just fine. Perfect. Okay. Awesome! Woohoo! Only a half an hour late. It's all good.
Sorry about that.
It's okay, everyone. Luckily, I was able to have a bit of a talk with Brenda, just talking a bit about week one. So, before we get started into the material, can I make sure that everybody's read the material? Week one? Everyone has their books and everything?
Yep.
You got your book. Brenda has her book. Krista, I know you have your book, so this is cool. All right, so did everybody get the reading done? I mean, it's okay if you didn't, just admit it, but...
Yep.
Did you?
I did.
Brenda did it? Brenda
yep.
did it. Leanne did not. Okay, Krista, did you get your reading done?
No.
Was I the only bad one, or was Krista bad too?
I was bad. Was
There's
really
no
bad.
Good or bad. Okay, how much of the reading did any of you get done?
I got done maybe a quarter of what I needed to do.
Okay. What Maybe. About you, Leanne?
And can I read what Dave said?
Yes.
He said, because I am not in negative judgment of this, I allowed it to inspire me to the idea of maybe I can manifest a new really good computer. Cheap. I went on eBay, and there it was. Dream system, really. Cheap. I purchased it, and that is what these creativity courses can help you do. When we are in the mindset of creativity, we are inspired to new opportunities, but when we are in victimization, we miss opportunities, we don't see them.
That was a really good piece of contribution. Thank you, Dave. All right, so I'm more interested in what it was that stood in both of your two of you, your way to from getting the right reading done.
I don't know. Leanne, you want to go first or you want me to go first?
Oh, I'll let you go first.
Yeah, Krista, go first.
Nice.
We had a little bit of conversation throughout the week.
We did. So I think for me, it's just been, I need to just set my schedule down and stick to my schedule. For me, that's the issue, is just sticking to it and not letting other things take me off. We had a family member, actually, that's why I have a bunch of people in my house right now, that was kidnapped in Mexico, and so I've been dealing with that and kind of being the liaison between everybody, and it's actually my ex. So it's been really hard, and I honestly have just kind of let that consume me, and then just working. And I think I'm in a much better place, though, because the cool thing is I've been able to journal. Mm-hmm. And because of the journaling, I've been able to put a lot of my...
I can't hear anyone.
So I think I can... I'm in a better place because I'm kind of getting that out there, but I just haven't taken the time to sit down and read. In my mind, I wanted to read last night and this morning, and I just came home and I just had to sleep. I feel like I'm mentally exhausted.
Mm-hmm. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes. Okay. Well,
that... So mine's just been choice. I mean, it just, you know, I could have taken the 15 minutes to read, you know, every day, but I've just been consumed doing everything else.
So how does that feel when you're consumed doing everything else instead of, like, taking time for, you know, things that you want to do?
Right now, frustrating. I think what I did do, though, is I took time,
Alexander.
And I listened to that, your video of your, it was like 2 hours or something, right? Because I totally was able to relate to you on a couple things that you said, and so the more realization of me.
What is it? What video was it that you were talking about? Oh, she dropped off.
Yeah, I think we lost her.
Okay. Happy. Hello. Can you talk?
Oh, there I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Hello. Sorry, a little late. Technical difficulties and mommy
it's
things.
It's okay. We've all been having them.
Awesome.
Difficulties.
I was like, oh my gosh, so late that it took a little bit to get on here.
Yeah, it took us about half an hour to actually get this thing started, so...
Wow, yeah.
You came at the perfect time.
Awesome. That's great. Good.
Well, I know I've been talking to you a little bit throughout the week. How are you doing? You got your reading done and everything?
Oh, me? Yes, absolutely. I'm very in love with this book, with the processes. It is... I'm like, wow, this is exactly what I've asked for, exactly. On my path of this, you know, and removing these blocks for myself, I'm like, wow, I didn't know something like this existed, or I would have had it in my hands so long ago. So, yeah, I couldn't stop myself from doing the end process of the things that you're supposed to do at the end of the book that you said wait. I was like,
that's perfect because for the motivated ones, like Brenda did them too. I mean,
oh,
she started
good,
attempting
I wasn't
them.
The only one.
You guys are bad girls.
Oh, I know. I tried. I was on step two and I was like, oh, I wasn't supposed to do that. And then in my head I heard, go for it because you're feeling so inspired. Just keep going.
Perfect.
And so I did. But yeah, I love it. I'm super happy. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, Krista actually dropped off right when you came on, so I'm going to let her continue to talk a little bit because she's
okay,
in the middle of explaining something, but I just wanted to kind of like check in with you really quick while I was waiting for her to get back on.
Awesome.
So Krista, you were in the middle of telling me about the video that you had seen of mine or something, but which one is it that you're talking about?
The one where you're talking about how you realized when you were in a relationship that, you know, in your mind you said, gosh, well, they're missing out on a good thing.
Uh-huh. Like, I can't believe that they would be so dumb to do something so stupid because look at what they're going to, you know what I'm saying, what they're going to miss out on. And it was, it felt like it was me talking because mm-hmm. those things have went through my mind in the relationship that I was in, and but I never voiced that. So because mm-hmm. in my mind, I always thought voicing that would be like, I'm selfish. Who are you to think that? Why are you so conceited? Why would you even say that? You know, the other voice telling you, why would you say that about yourself? Yet in reality, you're exactly right. I mean, you have to give yourself value. And I think if we devalue ourselves, then we allow everybody else to devalue us. So I didn't do the reading per se yet, but exactly what she said, I guess, really motivated me. These ladies are like way above and beyond. So if I just take the time and sit down and read it, I know I'm going to get a lot out of it, and I'm really excited about that. But I think for me, the journaling and kind of just getting a lot of the crap out has really yes. been positive for me, because I learn actually doing. You can't tell me and then I just learn. I actually have to learn doing it or visualizing and seeing it. I can't learn uh-huh. any other way. It's just not how I learn, and I've learned that over the years. So maybe for me it's just better. What I've been doing is journaling in the morning, just because uh-huh. I'm a morning person, and I've honestly been consumed with, you know, an hour of prayer time in the morning, and that's, I think, the main reason why I haven't read is because I usually read right in the morning, and because I've just been in so much prayer because of the situation, I just haven't taken the time to read, so.
Yeah. Well, sounds like you've been doing exactly what you've been needing to do, and that's awesome that you've at least been doing the main action step, which is the journaling, which is the most important one. Like if you refuse to do journaling, I feel like you should just stop this process because you're not going to get anywhere and it's going to frustrate you.
I actually went out and bought like a journal, and I was like, crap, those journals are expensive. But I knew I needed to have a place, you know, where I had it all, because I started out with like just, you know, pieces of paper. And I was mm-hmm. like, no, I need a journal book. And so I was at the store, and I'm like, you know what? They're like $5. And so I just bought one. And I'm like, I'm just going to buy one. And so that's what I've been doing.
You know, the funny thing is that since I started this process like 2 years ago of these like morning pages, I've like filled up like 12 like thick volumes of morning pages. And, you know, a lot of it is just like, you know, the mental dump stuff, and it's kind of something that you'll start noticing that it's something that you'll just want to continue doing even after this course is over, because it's just so helpful at mentally processing everything.
Mm-hmm.
So, is it okay if I share a little bit of like what you had shared with me throughout the week? Kind of.
Of course.
Okay, so Krista had actually come to me. I had checked in with her like in the middle of the week, and she told me that she was actually like hating this process. And I thought it was hilarious. I thought it was really important for us to all recognize that at certain points throughout this process, we're going to face our own resistance to everything, you know, because the morning pages are going to make it so that we are facing ourselves, and there will come times along the journey where we're like just not going to want to do them. We're not going to want to do the reading. We're not going to want to do the exercises. And those are not points in which you flagellate yourself or like punish yourself. It's more of an opportunity for you to sit there and be like, huh, well, what is it about me right now that is not in alignment with this? And why am I resisting this? Why am I resisting something that I know is for my betterment? And there will become a lot of answers in that, and things will start flowing, and you'll probably have a big breakthrough. But sometimes there's that challenge. So, do you happen to be doing your morning pages?
Sorry, Katerina. Uh-huh. Dave, he says he was trying to tap me on the shoulder. Dave said that, he says, this isn't mercy retrograde. He says, this is her temper tantrum. He says, our ability to perceive any external value is directly proportional to our ability to see our internal value. He says, we don't see the world as it is. We see it as we are. He says, I was trying to comment on what you were saying about that, but he seems to have lost his voice. Sorry, Dave, I wasn't looking to the right of my screen. I'll be better on that. I'm sorry.
It's okay. It was perfect. So happy, uh-huh. You were saying.
I didn't say anything. Did you ask me something?
I was asking you about your morning pages. How have you been feeling towards those?
Oh, I love it. Yes. I never knew that there was that type of writing that existed. And when I read about it, because I was like, what is that? So I looked it up and did a little research, and I was like, man, that was made for me. Because when I write, it takes me an hour to get something out. Like, I sit forever and ponder about what I've said, wondering if it's going to sound right, and erase some things and go over it. With this, you just write, and I'm like, oh, wow. And now I've decided that's the kind of writing that's for me. And so I love it.
I'm happy. You want to know the funny thing is that, like, that's how I do all of my writing.
That's awesome.
Ever since I discovered that a couple of years ago,
yeah. It's like,
there's no more blockage there, because you're not sitting there analyzing everything together.
Yes.
You know?
That's what it feels like.
Happy, do you feel? Sorry, I just had a question. Happy, do you feel like sometimes you write stuff that's, like, totally irrelevant? Like, if you get, instead of, like, telling somebody your pissed off or you got a situation, do you feel like you automatically write it now instead of just blowing off at that person? That's what I noticed throughout the week, that I was stressed, and so my stress went into my writing, and I just like, whoa, why am I writing this? It was just weird.
Yeah, it's a good release. Yeah, definitely. And okay. That is, yeah, it's just a flow of whatever comes out. And you know, sometimes I'm like, wow, I can't believe I just said that, but it's okay, because I just keep going forward, and it feels good, like I got it off, I feel better, you know. It's just a really good process. And I definitely feel like that, you know, for me, that's what I was saying, Katerina, that I feel like that's the writing that's made for me. Now I'm not even wanting to write even my blogs anymore in a way that I've got to go back and write and fix everything. I just want a stream of consciousness, right? So I love it. I definitely love it.
That's awesome. I wanted to talk a little bit more about, like, the actual chapter itself, because I think that this is a really important one for people to really understand and to get, and to have this as, like, a foundational platform for people to go forward on. You know, this idea of having a sense of safety. And without that, I think that having a successful creative recovery or even a creative launch of any kind is not possible. Because if we're not feeling secure in ourselves, and we're not feeling secure in what it is that we're trying to venture off and do, and we're not secure in the fact that we're about to be taking some risks in our lives and, you know, in ourselves and in our relationship with ourselves, like I was talking to you a little bit about this, Brenda, like this idea that you need to really keep that space for yourself. And oftentimes people have had, you know, family members or friends or people who are members, like authority figures, impede on that safety. And if we can do our best to buffer that and really be aware of our self-talk, and the people and the influences that we allow into our lives throughout this process of really having a dedicated space to that recovery, which is why I wanted to start this group, is because all of you are like-minded. All of you can support each other and support yourselves in the same time, like being able to have this successful recovery. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So like that is really like the framework of chapter.
Oh, it's on.
What's that? Is that you, Bobby?
I think it worked. I can't hear them.
Whoa, that's really loud.
Hi.
Hi, Bobby. It's a full house tonight. Okay. I'll introduce you in a second, Bobby, but I'm going to finish saying up what I'm doing right here, okay? Yes? Cool? All right. So Correct. So, yes, and we also were talking more about, like, the idea of the creative affirmations. Brenda, you said they sounded kind of hokey at first.
Oh, yeah.
can you talk to the group a little bit about that, like, your experience with that?
I think with me, it's just because the way I was brought up that you're never really supposed to, I guess, think of yourself type thing, right? And any kind of, not positive reinforcement, but to look at things like I am this or I am that or I am good, you know, to me, when I was growing up, that was kind of no, you don't do that kind of stuff, right? And so getting into this and getting over my internal censor was kind of difficult at first with these affirmations, right? Mm-hmm. But as I'm going along with them, they're, I guess they feel right to me now, you know, as I get into it. So it's becoming a definitely a positive process for me.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And Happy, you're no stranger to these affirmations, and you're no stranger to this idea of bringing that energy into your everyday life, right?
Oh, no, not at all. It's something that I've been practicing for some time now, so it is, and so it was easy for me to do them, but, you know, when I first started, it wasn't, you know, back when I first started doing affirmations, it was very hard because I had learned the opposite. You know, exactly. Just as she was saying, and so it was like, it took about a year for me to really internalize that, and, you know, this really is adding to it in a whole new light. It really is.
That's awesome. Oh, I'm so happy to share with you, Happy.
Oh, man, me too. I can't even express it. You know, like I said, the words just don't say enough.
So, did everyone have clarity on the tasks and everything? Like, so I know that you went ahead with them, Brenda and Happy, and I just wanted to talk about them a little bit, because, I mean, the first task, obviously, is doing those morning pages, you know, 3 pages of longhand, the stream of consciousness, and there's also really another key component is the fact that you don't reread these. Do not go back and reread them, because that's where the judgment comes in, and you're starting to, like, you know, be like, oh, I did this so well, and oh, this was really bad, and, you know, that's not the point of these. This isn't, like, a writing exercise where you're going to go post this around in public. You know, you're going to keep this away from yourself for a little while, and you're just going to have it as that dump space. You're going to have it as a dumping ground, so to speak, where you're going to be able to just let out whatever the hell it is that you want.
So we're not supposed to go back and read them?
No, not for a while.
Okay.
And to keep them very safe.
Yeah, that was my first thought. I was like, oh shit, there's a lot of stuff in here.
Well, the reason that you don't go back and reread them is what I just said, is the judgment factor, is that we tend to judge ourselves, and especially at this point in the process, there is a lot of judgment and volatility that could be running around, especially since you just embarked on something that has the potential to do a lot of change and a lot of growth in your life. It's just better to not read them right now. There's a point later in the book where, you know, that says go ahead and reread them, but it's just something where you're not there yet. So go ahead and just, like, continue to do them. Put them, like they say, in a manila envelope or hide them from yourself and other people, of course. You don't really want that stuff laying around. and it just, I mean, as you go along this process, you're probably going to become a lot more aware of, like, the things that you're continually complaining about. And that's part of the point, is that you're going to be seeing your mind on paper, and eventually you're going to be able to see, like, the areas in which you really need to be changing something. Like, you know, maybe you're not happy in the work that you're doing right now. Maybe you're not happy in the relationship you're in because you're noticing you're complaining about it a lot. You know?
Everything works, so why don't you just come on?
What is that?
It sounds like an alien spacecraft.
What? Sounds like Xander. That's Xander.
No, it's called She Can't Hear Katerina for some reason, so...
We all hear you.
Yeah, I know.
We see you.
I don't know why we can't hear Katerina, so...
Well, there's going to be recording, don't worry about it. Can you tell them that, Krista?
She said that there's going to be a... Xander. Alexander.
Yes?
She said that there's going to be a recording of it, not to worry about it.
I don't know. Like, she hears you. She
I know.
It's okay.
Katerina said it's okay. It's recording, she said, and this is distracting. So not to worry about it because your mom will be able to watch the recording.
Okay. I don't. Okay.
So,
I'll let her
so
know.
So just mute it. Thank you.
Just mute it, please. Thank you. Got to put on the big boy pants.
She said, sorry, you got to put on the big boy pants.
Well, I was saying, I have to put on my big boy pants.
Now, Dave is talking over here on the right-hand side. Sorry, I'm trying to... He said earlier, he said that he loved that video. He says, we're all just doing the best that we can. It's just one of those days, he says, reminds him of Leja Trinanen's whatever the heck, that food dance. And I was like, what? I go, you dork. I guess I have no idea who Leja even is. And he goes, Katerina knows. She's another YouTuber doing similar to Katerina. Go ahead and ask Katerina who Leja Trinanen is.
Oh, Leja.
Well, he says L-E-I-J-A. Sorry. Okay.
Yeah, it's a Scandinavian pronunciation.
He says, Katerina is happy and happy is happy. I guess we really all are all one.
Okay. All right. Is it all right with everybody if I get back on track?
Yep.
All distractions aside? Because, I mean, it's already like 8 o'clock for me almost. And I go to bed early here. But, okay, so the second one is the artist date, and that's one thing that it's easy to skip out on, because if we've had a tendency to, like, neglect ourselves and to put ourselves on the back burner, we'll easily be able to justify for ourselves, you know, that artist date thing, you know, it's kind of superfluous, and I don't really think I need that. But, you know, the idea, though, is that when you're out by yourself and you're really not having distractions around, you know, you're not having a bunch of people infiltrating your space, because creativity really happens a lot when you're by yourself. And even, like, half an hour to an hour of just self, by yourself time, like going out on a walk, taking your camera, going out and just, you know, to the beach or wherever you want to go, like even going to a local cafe and people watching for a little bit, going to the local dollar store and playing around with, like, stupid, like, you know, kitty glasses and, you know, streamers and all that kind of stuff. Like, that can be so enjoyable for your little self, your creative self. And if you skip out on that stuff, I mean, you're missing half of this, because part of this is to really, like, get you to be taking those action steps and getting yourself to be more creative. And if you can't do something simple as, like, spending some time with your artist, then this is going to be really challenging. So I just want to pre-warn you guys that if you start noticing yourself slipping on the pages and on the artist date, you need to really be checking in and to see what's going on internally. The third one that is a task for this week, and Happy and Brenda, did you say that you needed to go back and redo some of these because you didn't?
Yeah, like the first, the writing the letters to yourself and going back and doing the time travel thing, right?
Uh-huh.
I need to relook at those, yeah.
Okay.
Because I'm drawing a blank when it comes to those, because like I said, I don't really have many memories of childhood, right? So.
Yeah. And Happy, did you go through and do the tasks?
I did, yeah. I did all of the...
just for some examples, do you think that you could share with me and the group some of your tasks that you did?
You might not want me to. They're kind of personal. I don't know.
Well, only if you're comfortable. Only if you're comfortable. Like number three.
Number three. I'd have to find it. They're not just like little lines. They're pages of stuff, Katerina.
There's
a lot of blocks that I feel myself removing. So I'm just letting it all come out. Like
that's
lots.
Awesome. Well, can you tell me at least who your three old enemies were?
Yes. Was that number three?
Yeah.
Okay. Number one is my mom and dad.
Okay.
Number two is two of my aunts. And number three was my fifth grade teacher, Miss Castleberry.
Oh. I have some of those.
Yeah, those were very strong, so.
I thought the funny thing, okay, because I actually went back and illustrated mine when I did this the first time. I still have the picture. I should actually put it in the Facebook group because it's really funny.
Yes.
I did these little illustrations. But one of them was this this college recruiter at the Emily Carr Institute or something like that, the school in Canada that I had applied to. And I really wanted to be accepted there because, you know, I'm a Canadian citizen. And I was like, yeah, I really want to be the school because it's a really great school and blah, 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 blah. And I went up there, you know, specifically for this portfolio day. And I was crushed because they told me that my work was too stiff and I needed variety. And, you know, here I had poured my heart and soul into this portfolio. And I was totally crushed because I just really wanted, you know, them to like me. I just really wanted their approval.
Yeah.
And, you know, I totally projected for a long time just like the fact that, you know, I didn't think I was good enough on this one like stuffy British dude. And that stuffy British dude was the bane of my existence for about 2 years.
Yeah.
And then I realized like what crap that was.
Yeah.
I let him ruin my life.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, you know, like, some of the other ones, like, he sticks out in my mind. I gotta go back and look at what my other thing was. But I think my other two were, I think my other one was, like, my dad or something. Like, because I thought that he didn't want me to be creative because being creative is not, like, a good profession or whatever. And,
yeah.
You know, like, this kind of thing. And you know, these little things just get implanted in our subconscious and they flourish. And then they take over our lives, and then they totally control us unconsciously. And it's devastating.
It really is, yeah.
Yeah. And let's see, what was my other one? Gosh, I have to post a picture, but those were my main two.
Wow.
Oh, did you actually write out your horror story from your Monster Hall of Fame?
I did. Yes. Yes. Who was? I have a question for you. What was your the image? Did you draw the image like it says for your like instead of the snake or the serpent? You know what it says to think of an image as mm-hmm. your. I've lost my train of thought on what exactly it was called, but I can't remember. It's in one part of the book where she says, have an image of the creative. The voice in your head that's telling you, no, you're not good enough.
I've done a couple pictures of it. Mine was, like, at the time that I did this whole process was when I had fibromyalgia. I was extremely ill, and like I had all of these like core beliefs about, you know, the fact that I was sick, and I had all of these creative dreams that I really wanted to accomplish and get through to, you know, the world. You know, I really wanted to like put myself out there in that way, but I had like this sickly Katerina that, you know, is like, oh, you can't because you're too sick and you can't do it. You don't have the stamina for that. You don't have this. You don't have that. And so I drew her, you know, in like her like you know, creepy, decrepit ways. And
wow.
I just put a big X through it.
That's perfect.
I was like, this is bullshit. And, you know, there's something about doing that that really, mm-hmm. really helped. I'm not saying that was, like, the only thing that helped me, but, like, it's been 2 years, and I don't have fibromyalgia anymore.
That's,
you know,
yeah.
like, how many people can say
that's
that?
That's awesome.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
that's
I
awesome.
Mean, for me, like, this process has been life-changing, transformational. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm so passionate about this, and that's why I really, like, I'm wanting to bring as many people into, like, this circle of, you know, creative recovery as possible, because this is, like, the power within it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 2 years later, I'm not bedridden, and I'm not, like, laying down and playing dead anymore. I'm, like, yeah. out in fucking Costa Rica, like, hanging out. You know, like, that's cool.
That's
right?
awesome. Absolutely. That's awesome.
And, like, the fact that all of you are in my life, like, that's a testament to the fact that there is creative energy happening and circulating.
Mm-hmm.
There's like, this spiritual electricity that is, like, pulsing through all of us. And it's just
yes.
a matter of undamming that and, like, letting it burst out, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's awesome.
Yeah. So, there was also these, just for the people, like Krista, I don't know if you're still there. Your screen's muted out. But there was, like, these time travel exercises where, you know, you write down your horror story from your Monster Hall of Fame, which I kind of spoke to you all because, you know, the fogey old British dude telling me I can't paint. Damn him. But no, seriously, when you really, like, you know, you're like, damn him, like, there's that energy that comes up, and it just fuels you to kind of propel out of that apathy, you know?
Yeah.
So, and that's really what spiritual stuckness and, you know, creative stuckness is. It's apathy on a really deep level. It's resignedness. It's just a resignation, resignedness. I just made up a word, guys.
That's good.
So, Happy, can you tell me what your three old champions were?
Yes.
Three old champions of your creative support.
Those three old champions. Okay. Hall of Champions? Is that the one? The Hall of Champions?
Yes.
Okay. Number one is my love. Number two is my third grade teacher, Miss Hallenkack. And number three was my Aunt Rhonda.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
What were some of the compliments that they gave you?
You know, I can't, like, recall just one or two. It's just a feeling they gave me when I was around them.
Mm-hmm.
The assuredness they gave me, the confidence in me, that, you know, just the way they were to me, that,
yeah.
you know, the directions they took me, the just all of those things that I can feel when I think about them. So I couldn't write down specific words, but just, you know, a feeling. And that means more to me, really, than words can say. So
mm-hmm.
a lot of compliments. I even when I did this, I realized that I used to draw, and I didn't even remember. I used to draw when I was in third grade, and I had a vivid image. I was drawing a cross, and it was for a boyfriend that I had at the time or something. But my teacher, Ms. Hallenkack, would always say, that's beautiful, you know, that's great. And she would just always smile at me and say, you know, just keep going. And then I would go home, and it was like the opposite. Oh, you're not as good as your sister, you know, or whatever. And it was like, you know, so I stayed in school to do all of my art, you know, and now that brought back so many memories. It was like, whoa, I didn't know that was in there. So, yeah.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
Hey, Brenda.
Yes.
Did you happen to do the Imaginary Lives exercise?
No, I didn't do that one yet. I've
Which...
thought about it, right?
Okay.
But
cool.
I actually didn't get to the point of writing them down.
Well, can you tell me your thoughts? What is it that you think that you would like to do, your five lives you'd like to lead?
Well, actually, when I was growing up, I always wanted to be either a vet or a nurse, somewhere in there, right? I've spoken to many people over the last few years. They say that I have a natural ability. People seem to be attracted to me for healing or whatever, right? And I've always been able to establish close relationships with that. But, you know, years ago when I thought about going in to become a vet, I was always told, no, you can't do that because, you know, you become too attached to people and you become too attached to the animals and, you know, it'll kill you, right? So I eventually just kind of moved away from that. But those are the two things that I really, really wanted to do. Or become some sort of counselor. You know, I've always found that wherever I've worked, I've always seemed to be the resident counselor. And everybody and their problems always ended up in my office, right? So I seem to have a natural ability for those kind of things. So, you know, I have looked into possibly moving myself that way, like now. But again, it's kind of to the thing was like, you can't do that, or you're getting too old, right? You know? So it's like, I'm 43, you're too old.
Oh, hooey.
You know? But there, you know, that's your inner critic, right? You know, exactly. And you always find so many ways to not do something as opposed to do something. And so going through this, it's starting to get me to turn around and look at, you know, maybe I'm not so old. So.
No, I really would never have even guessed you were 43.
Over the hill.
Well, so those sound like those are the two things that really, like, you really want to care for people. You really want to care for things, right? Like,
yes.
That seems to be, like, the theme behind, like, your imaginary lives. What can you do right now to kind of bring you closer to that? I mean, I'm not saying you need to go out and get your, like, your doctorate in psychology and start treating people or something like that. But, like, what can you do right now? Or what are you already doing that is fulfilling that for you?
I haven't really done anything as per se, other than just, like I said, being there for people in previous work experiences, right? Mm-hmm. Just giving them a place to feel safe to open up, right, to me and stuff like that. So that's pretty much all I've really done in that aspect of it. So I had started looking into psychology and I got 1 year of it, but I'm finding that that's too clinical for me because I know that there's way more to it than just the mind, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so it was to the point where I just couldn't do that anymore because it's so much bigger. And so it's to find a place where it encompasses everything, you know, your mind, your soul, everything is kind of why the direction I would like to move towards, right?
Well, there's lots of avenues for that kind of stuff out there. I mean, if you're really truly interested in that. So what kind of avenue are you thinking?
I have gotten my Reiki. I've gotten my levels 1 and 2 on those, right?
Yeah, me too.
So there's, you know, those are the kind of ways that I like. You know, I really enjoy working with crystals and stuff like that as well, right? And the energy part of things. Mm-hmm. So I think eventually focus more on those areas, maybe look into becoming a naturopath or something like that eventually.
Really cool.
Yeah, I'd like it.
Awesome. So I'm interested in what you were talking about, counseling. And like, what about that are you wanting to do with that? Because naturopathy, you know, it's still pretty clinical in the sense that you're dealing with diseases and of the body, not too much of the mind.
But I think it all It's all somewhat integrated, right? Like, I believe that your mindset and everything has a lot to do with your physical health and how stuff impacts, right? And, but, you know, I've had, like, in the past, like, I've had brothers that have been, I guess, really afflicted with drug and alcohol abuse, right? And one just was 2 years ago, actually ended up committing suicide because of it all, right? Mm-hmm. And so being able to see people in that area and try and help them, right, make them see, or to be able to fight their demons, I guess, in other ways other than, like, over-medicating themselves with all of this stuff, right? So because I've seen it and everything that it can do to people, that would be, like, a nice, I guess, an area that I would like to gravitate towards in the counseling end of things, right? Mm-hmm. Just to be able to help people that way. Yeah, seeing a lot of destruction in my family because of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I'm curious, because I think this is, like, a really interesting, like, entry point conversation with you. What, are there any other, like, kind of imaginary lives that you would like to lead, like, you know, purely fun speaking? Because, I mean, I feel like your approach to this is very, like, linear, thought out, like, this is what I would like to do because of this and this and this. But is there anything that there's that you would like to do or be or, you know, enjoy just because it would sound fun?
Yeah, like painting and stuff, like an artist, right? And that's mm-hmm. something that I've always imagined a life being like. I've also thought about, you know, becoming, like, owning coffee shops and stuff like that where you can get in and out and meet people and, mm-hmm. you know, integrate, like, art and gift stores and all that kind of stuff, something that appeals to people's five senses, right? So that was kind of always a fun, whimsical thing for me.
Ah, I like that. Do you go to coffee shops a lot?
I used to. I don't so much anymore, right? But I like the atmosphere of something that's really kind of cozy and close, right? You know, like, I know exactly how I would do it, right? Like, I can see it in my mind, how everything's all laid out, and even what the building is made out of, like, type thing, right? So I can visualize all of it, right? Mm-hmm. But again, it's just a matter of, you know, chicken and shit.
Chicken shit?
Yeah, because you kind of have to put yourself out there, right? And
you know, really
I've always
funny.
Been behind the scenes.
Oh, yeah. I was going to tell you, there's something really funny. I actually, there's this group of friends that I knew, like, a couple of years ago, who had this wild idea to start up a coffee shop, and everybody thought they were crazy. But, like, 5 years later now, they're actually running an extremely successful coffee shop that is in, you know, the Beaverton location where, you know, I'm originally from. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's very cozy, you know, the decor is all very vintage and everything like that. It's very tactile, everything is very artsy. You know, some of my yeah. first art shows that I ever had were hosted there. And it was actually a group of people together that started up this coffee shop. So not just one person had to be putting themselves out there. Like, everybody could specialize in whatever it was that they were good at. And I think that that's really the best way for things to happen is people, you know, just specializing in what they're good at and letting the other people who are, you know, maybe a little bit better with the marketing or maybe a little bit better with the public relations, like, to take care of that stuff. Right. And then everybody is just, like, you know, helping build something together. You know, the coffee shop is called Insomnia, and it's, like, a very cool, like, hipster venue now for people to come to. And, you know, so, I mean, it's, like, it's definitely doable, and it's definitely, like, these ideas are not that far off. And I think that that's part of the recovery process is, like, these ideas of these imaginary lives that are oh so crazy and so oh so out there.
Yeah.
They start to become a little bit more of a belief in reality for us.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the biggest thing, like, it's that risk and the fear of failure and all of those mm-hmm. things, right, that, you know, you kind of grow up with all your life, and so it's just like, yeah,
keeps
it's safer.
Box.
Yeah, you know, it's safer to be over here than over here, right?
I can relate to that.
Yeah.
I have a bit of a story about that, if you two don't mind. I feel like you two and Dave are the only ones present right now. Everybody seems to be dropping off, but I think that's okay. We can listen to the recording later. I don't care. It's like, oh, too many distractions. But for me, it's like, I told you guys a little bit about my background, you know, bedridden, stuck in a bed for like a while because I had, you know, the chronic fatigue, the fibromyalgia, and I was just totally, my body was just a mess. And, you know, with that process, I continued to like sort of push my boundaries little by little, you know, of like what I was comfortable with. Yeah. You know, there were points where I really felt like I couldn't even be that far away from my house because I was like afraid that, you know, what if I needed to sleep? What if I needed to eat? Like, there were points in which I was just so uncomfortable with the idea of not having my comfort zone that I would have, like, a panic attack because I was like, I can't do that. I can't go out camping for a weekend. Oh, my gosh, I can't go eat at a restaurant because I don't have, like, my everything that I need in order to do it, you know? And, like, that is such a mental trap for you to stay in. And that was something that I started realizing was, like, how confining that was. And as I'm talking, feel free to relate to this to your own experience because, I mean, you may not have experienced this exactly, but the whole mental construct is the same. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So the more that we kind of nudge those boundaries of what it is that we're comfortable with, the more life we actually will be able to get to experience and to bring into our awareness. Because when our perception of what we're capable of is this big, mm-hmm. this is all we're going to see. And so when you start taking off some of these barriers and, you know, you start doing some research and you start, you know, finding ways in which, huh, maybe this could work this way. You open up yourself to more and more experience. So that is my thought on that. Take it for what you will.
That's awesome.
No, that's good.
That's awesome.
The funny thing is that it's gotten so far to the point where I'm, like, you know, like, away from my doctors and everything like that, and I, like, I'm like, seriously in a third world country where it's, like, I have, like, no potential medical treatment if I need it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm totally okay with that.
Yeah,
and
that's
opposite
very
ends
cool.
of the spectrum. Yeah.
It's totally opposite of spectrum, right?
Yeah.
Like, but that's like, the mental
that's what
landscape.
I was saying.
The mental landscape I really hope for some of you to be able to achieve because there's so much more freedom there and your creativity and your flexibility is able to think in more terms of how can I rather than I can't.
Yes.
But the
yes.
That's
what
I.
How can
you
I?
Know.
I'm going to write that down.
Well, if you all follow directions, you'd have notepads and paper right there.
I do.
I
didn't
know
some
notes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's like the fundamental basis of it is how can I? Creativity.
Yeah, it's funny how it's always, it seems to be so more natural to think of like, why you can't than why you can. And that's the thing that always kind of has baffled me somewhat is like, why is that a part of our nature?
Yeah. Why? Because other people told us it was.
You know? Crazy.
Contrast. Yeah.
Contrast.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think the good thing about going through all this is when you're able to recognize, I guess, the programming that we received as kids and so on and so forth, at least we're aware now that, and then you can prevent doing that to your children and then so on and so forth, so you stop the cycle now, right?
Yes,
mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Which is a good thing.
Yeah, very good thing.
My mom is a perfect example of that. I mean, that blonde lady, that's my mother. She's here supporting, like, this, like she literally is on this because she wants to learn from her daughter. Like, that's
and that's awesome.
Yeah, that is.
Because she's been able to recognize some of her patterns and her ways of thinking and stop it in its tracks, and then that was able to have more open space for me, being her daughter, to actually, like, learn, expand, and grow in. I mean, I didn't, like, have my own societal programming to work through. Of course I did, because she wasn't my only influence.
Right.
But, you know, it just made it a lot easier when I had an adult that really understood and was able to encourage the creativity, encourage me to, you know, follow my dreams and to be who I am and to never really make me feel like I was bad or wrong or different for doing so.
Yeah, you know? That's awesome.
So, I mean, I know you two have children, yes, and I think that's so cool that you two are, you know, the way that you are, because your kids are, like, going to grow up to be so spectacular. I just love that.
You know, I don't like to say normal because I'm not really keen of normal.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Totally not normal. But spectacular, yeah.
There you go.
Magical, majestic. Okay, and the check-ins are something that are a big deal. Did either of you do your check-ins?
I did, and I did all of my morning pages all week, right? I ended up going to Michael's for my artist date, right?
Beautiful.
I love wandering around that store and looking at things and trying to say, oh, I could do this, I could do that, I could do this, right? You know, I'd have a house full of sparkly stuff if I could.
I love that.
So, yeah, it was good.
So how did it feel? In general.
It was awesome, right? It's nice to be able to get out there and I guess kind of feel the excitement, right? And all of those, I don't know, it's cool. So I ended up buying some paints and some paintbrushes and another canvas.
Nice.
So just kind of give yourself permission to play, right?
Exactly. That's what this is about. What about you, Happy?
My artist check-in is today, the check-in that we do. I set it for today, so I'll be doing it when we're done with this.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. And I actually set my artist date for Tuesday because I thought it'd be better to project it into next week. So it's set for every Tuesday at 10 a.m. So.
Ah, I like that.
Yeah.
That's cool, though, that you've actually set a schedule for it, because then you're probably going to be more likely to keep that schedule.
Yeah, it's on my calendars till infinity. Till awesome.
I love that. So, there was one more question, you know, the idea of any significant things that have happened to you in this past week that are, like, significant for your recovery, Brenda? Have you had any of those yet?
I don't think so. Nothing earth-shattering, I guess. Mm-hmm. Just a lot of little things.
Do you care to share any of those?
Again, I guess to me the biggest thing is just giving myself permission to play, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and getting rid of that internal censor or that critic that wants to judge absolutely every step I take,
mm-hmm.
you know? So that's good, to be able to get past that.
Yeah, I would say so. That is a pretty significant, hallmark in your recovery, I would say. Like, that, if you're able to stick with that, that's going to really carry you a lot.
Mm-hmm.
because that I think is like the biggest thing for people to overcome and to be aware of and to be able to like really keep an awareness and keep it in check.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think my biggest thing is I've never seen myself as a perfectionist, right? But then when you really start looking at things and your behaviors, I have found that there are, I guess, aspects of a perfectionist within me, because then if I don't do something absolutely perfect the first time, then it's I can't do this, right? Mm-hmm. You know, because it doesn't turn out the way I think it should. So it's, you know, giving yourself permission to, you know,
make bad art.
There you go.
You know, yeah. Like, that was one of my big breakthroughs, too, is because I have so much bad art that no one ever sees. But it's true, you know, like, I keep it at my mom's house because I don't want to deal with it at my house. Like, I just, like, but it's aww, true, though, because, I mean, like, but I came to a realization, though, that the bad art that I make is just, like, helps me be one step closer to a good piece of art. Because
exactly.
It's, like, I'm working through things, and sometimes the ideas that I have don't necessarily work out the way that I'm seeing them, just kind of like experiences in your life. Like, mm-hmm. I'm not, you know, I've definitely always followed my heart, but sometimes it always has been like the wisest choice. Uh-huh. It all laid the groundwork that I needed for me to get to a place where I really was happy and really did want to be, you know?
Yeah.
In terms of like relationships, like sometimes you need to have like a couple really bad relationships for you to actually know what you want.
I've done that.
But like, you know, Abraham Hicks says that it's like it's this contrast, it's this sorting, uh-huh, sifting experience. And so to not judge yourself for making the bad piece of art or having the bad boyfriend or having the bad experience in your life that really stopped you and clogged you up and made you feel all angry and sad. I mean, like, it was seriously a learning experience. It was a platform for you to jump off to get to the next one.
Right.
Yeah.
So make that place. Art.
Make that art.
Make so much bad art, it's not even funny. Because that's how you're going to make good art, is by making a lot of bad art.
Oh, yeah. Got the bad stuff covered.
But isn't it funny, though, that sense of needing it to be perfect and the perfectionism and everything like that? It's like, oh, my God, this is bad art. I can't handle this. I can't keep going because this is so much bad art. I can't handle this because I don't approve of it. Oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, my God. Like, that happens.
Yeah. Yeah, it's almost scary to keep going, though, when you realize that and you're like, oh, this is terrible. This is the worst thing I've ever done. And it just kind of, like, takes you to a different place. And it's like, man, you could have done better. So I just got to make it. I just got to make the bad art and be okay with it and know I'm bouncing off from there.
Because all of it is growing on each other, you know, because you're realizing what works, what doesn't work. And, mm-hmm, you know, like, the funny thing, too, is sometimes we can't really judge, like, a piece of work, like, you know, the like, three-fourths of the way into it. Like, it's just terrible. You know, like, and then maybe it's, like, the last fourth of it that we actually are like, oh, this looks kind of cool. Like, for instance, this little painting that I did just, like, the other day.
Right.
It looks cool now. But I spent, like, the first three-fourths of my time painting it being like, oh, my God, what am I doing? I don't ever use these colors. I don't ever do landscape paintings. What am I thinking? Oh, my God. And, you know, it's like you can be aware of that conversation, but don't let it stop you.
Yeah. And that, for me, I think that's the hardest part, right?
Yeah, me too. Definitely. Mm-hmm.
But now we're bringing awareness to it. And what are we going to do?
Keep going and make that bad art.
How do you both think that you can hold your inner critic? How do you both think that you can relate to it?
With me, I think I'm really becoming more aware of it, right? And I've gotten to the point now where I can stop it and turn it around. You know, like there's some days where it'll get completely out of control, right? And it'll run forever, that little gremlin.
Maybe you could do this at it.
Wow.
That's another aspect of you, right?
I never thought of that.
Oh, absolutely.
You can totally talk back to your inner critic.
Yeah. Oh, I do.
You can give it the finger if you want.
Yeah, I talk to myself a lot, apparently.
I do, constantly.
Yeah.
You know, that's one really great place. I'm gonna say this before we like start wrapping up is, you know, in your morning pages, you can actually, you know, vocalize that conversation with yourself and really like talk back to yourself, like the negativity that you're having. You know, that's been a really good thing for me over the years is just to be like, oh my God, you're full of shit. You know.
Yeah, because, you know, a lot of times for me to, you know, kind of handle the inner critic is to just realize I am where I am and that's okay, and then start doing positive affirmations towards it. You know, that's normally what I do, but in this instance, I'm trying to get to the core bottom of what is causing all of this, where did it all come from, so I can actually move that energy and leave it in a new place, because I realize, you know, for the last few years, I've done positive affirmations, and I know, you know, that Abraham, you know, from Abraham, you should be able to do this, this, and this, and I know those things, but my something in my mindset has not allowed me to venture there yet. So I know that this next step is what I'm doing now, and moving that energy. Yeah, I'm like, wow, this is so perfect. I mean, absolutely. So, yeah, just positive affirmations and the blocks. And actually, my inner critic is called Grumpy Bear. First thing I imagined was Grumpy Bear. So I just X the little Grumpy Bear, and I'm like, not today. You can be Shy Bear, but not grumpy. But, you know, it's okay to be grumpy and just get it all out and say, okay, now this is, you know, the positive affirmation I'm going to give you, you know. So
that's awesome.
That's what's working for me.
You know, the funny thing is my inner critic is called Ogarina. And
oh,
this is one...
nice.
Do you remember the Halloween costume that I made? Uh-huh. Happy that you, like, well, this was around Halloween, like, in October. I think maybe you had commented on it or something, but, like, I had literally, like, painted my face with, like, Yeah.
I do remember. That's why it sounded familiar. Yes.
That's my alter ego. That's the Katerina that, you know, was so sick and, you know, you know, like that's who that is. And like one really useful skill that, you know, Dave Kelso, which is why I have him on these calls, is because he's been one of my biggest helps in helping me get through things, like, as well as this book. And there's just so many different facets, which is why I wanted to put it into a course, because it's like, you know, you could read the book, but it's kind of like you're missing most of it, you know, like, I don't know. The conversation is really where the magic is at.
Yeah.
The point, though, is that with having a more of a humorous attitude towards the grumpy bears in both all of us, you know, it lessens the energy resistance, and it actually helps it be a little more humorous. And sometimes there are times when you're really not in a good mood to be wanting to laugh at your pain, but it's like sometimes it really does help, and you just have to be a little bit more discerning.
Yeah.
But He really showed me that in order to, like, get through some of those blocks, more of a lighthearted attitude was necessary. And I had a choice between being Ogarina or Pele, you know, like, you know, fire goddess. And just, like, and I think using those archetypes is really helpful, because it kind of takes you out of the picture, and it just really sort of externalizes to you the dynamic that's going on, so you don't really feel too caught up in it. It's like, oh, that's my grumpy bear coming out, you know, or oh, that's my Ogarina coming out. and then you're not feeling bad, guilty, or wrong for that aspect occurring.
I never thought of that. Yeah. That's
So, who is your internal critic, Brenda?
I haven't named it yet, but maybe I should. I'm just, you know, some days it's just like, oh, quit being a bitch. Right? So, but maybe that's what I need to do. I need to give it a name.
Put that in your homework, is find out who that is that's talking.
And I had read a book by Colette Baron-Reed called The Map a couple years ago. And part of her process is to, like, to identify the gremlins, and that's your critic, right? Mm-hmm. And it was to draw a picture of the gremlins, and, you know, it's usually the ugliest thing is it, you know, it can be. And then, you know, it's what her thing is, like, then just burn it, right? Get rid of it.
And my process is a little different, because it's like, have fun with them, bring them to the table, learn from them. See what it is that they're holding on to and keeping from you, and because my whole thing's about integration, really, at the end of the day.
Whoa.
That was
what was that?
I have no idea. It's the gremlins, guys. How perfectly timed.
Yeah.
But you know what I mean, though? It's like, it's not about separating further something that's already separated from you, something that already is something that you want to disassociate from. It's about kind of reintegrating it and becoming whole again, because it has really good information for you, these gremlins, these inner critics, but it's just a process of learning from them rather than being inundated by them.
Mm-hmm.
So, therefore, I mean, that's why I kind of joke and play with Ogarina, because, you know, she was a protective mechanism for a long time, and I understand why she became who she was, and mm-hmm. do you know what I'm saying? So it's like,
yeah.
I don't want to burn her, I don't want to get rid of her, because she served a purpose. Her purpose is no longer necessary in my life, but she still kind of lurks around in the shadows in the back of my mind, and I still am aware of her.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so it has its place, right? And as long as you can keep it in check, I guess that's the main thing, right?
Yeah, because you can't ever really get rid of your darkness, and that's never our goal. It's more so to understand the darkness, bring it to light, and really kind of, like, look at it and be like, hey, what's going on here? You know, what is
right.
this showing me right now?
Mm-hmm. That makes sense, yeah.
Yeah. Well, Happy, I hope she gets back on the call, because that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was.
This triage. But, it's been about 1 hour and 10 minutes. Oh, good. Okay.
Yeah,
so that
was good.
Do you have any last questions or anything going into week 2?
No, I don't think so. So I'm, you know, based on what you said, I'm going to go back and relook at those time travel things, right? And, you know, do some more searching.
Mm-hmm.
So,
awesome.
Yeah, that'll be good.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
And what else? Is this a good time for you, Sunday nights at this time?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's good.
Okay, because I'm thinking maybe Saturday nights are a little more challenging for people because it's, like, party night and, you know, people are wanting to, like, go be with people because Sunday night is typically not a party night, you know?
Yeah, it's more relaxed and laid back. So, yeah, no, that would work good.
Okay, cool, because I think I'm going to keep this time because I think it's better for everyone. Rather than me competing with holiday parties and stuff like that. So.
There you go.
All right. Well,
awesome.
I am going to go to bed. It's been a long day. And I look forward to seeing you next week. I look
That'll
forward
be
to it. Seeing some more of your progress. And feel free to, you know, share some of the stuff that's going on with you like in the group, because I think that that would be really good for everyone else, especially some of the people who haven't quite yet fully like immersed themselves in the process. So. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah, that would be awesome.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
All right.
Take care.
You too.
Sleep well.
Have a good night. Okay. Talk to you later. Bye.